Now what I have, these two are considered hobby level incubators. They each will set 42 eggs. Now it's not necessary for you to have two incubators. I have two because I use one as a backup. And even though I'm only incubating 12 eggs, these eggs are fairly valuable. And I leave one incubator absolutely dry. The second incubator I'll run at an equal temperature, but it will have water in it so I can increase the humidity. And as the eggs progress in their incubation period, if these show that they have the right size air cell, they'll remain in this incubator. I have the optional egg turner as well. Now, if it shows that they're losing moisture too fast, I'll transfer those eggs into another incubator that already has moisture and the humidity level is higher. These incubators are made by Little Giant and they have the forced air unit. I find personally that the forced air units are more stable and are easier to control in a room where temperatures may change periodically. Now these are the egg cups that the eggs will sit in. I like that. They're easy to clean, but keep in mind that we're pre-sanitizing the eggs before we put them in. There's also a thermometer that comes with the unit, and it's already marked at 99.5 degrees, which is the optimum temperature for incubating in a forced air unit. Now these styrofoam units hold temperatures great. The only drawback I find is that they're difficult to sanitize between hatches. The companies that manufacture them have offered disposable trays that you can put in the unit, which makes it easier to clean out later, but I find that pathogens can even go to the surface of the incubator and you never feel that you've completely sanitized it. So I don't hatch in these units, I only incubate. Now that the eggs are sanitized and dried, we'll go on to prepare the incubator. We're only setting 12 of these eggs. The rest are for a larger incubator. The friend that gave me the eggs has an incubator capacity of over 800. And since we're having a break here in the middle of January, he didn't want to start up a giant incubator just for that purpose, so we're doing the 12 here on a hobby scale incubator. Now that this unit is reading 99.5, I'll take my calibrated thermometer and insert it in the other unit just to make sure that they're both balanced and that the temperatures are accurate. This one's at 99.4, so that's an acceptable parameter for incubation. Next, we'll place the eggs. The indicator light on the Little Giant should blink on and off pretty consistently. That shows you that it's holding its current temperature. When you initially set up the Little Giant and you haven't established it at 99.5, you want to turn this dial clockwise until this light stays on. Have a thermometer where you can observe it, and then as it gets up to temperature, when it hits 99.5, turn this dial counterclockwise until the light goes off. That's a good starting point for fine-tuning your incubator. After your hands are sanitized, you can handle the eggs that have also been sanitized. You can hold them up to a bright light, and then you can see if there are imperfections in the shell, which may cause problems during the hatch. It also gives you a chance to look at the air cell at the rounded side of the egg to see how large it is, and this indicates freshness of the egg itself. Do this visual inspection with every egg prior to placing it in the incubator. There's a linear indication here which shows that this shell's cracked. I wouldn't put it in for incubation. This is an example of a shell, even though it has variable thicknesses and light passes through at different levels. This egg is actually okay for incubation. Always turn the eggs carefully and slowly. When you're putting them in the incubator, remember the pointed end goes down. The same is true for storage. And the air cell, or rounded end, always goes up. Here's a Bantam egg, as compared to a standard Rhode Island Red brown egg. Some light-colored shells seem to be easier to see through when they're held up to a light. I've turned the incubator unit off while we load the eggs. It's important to put all the eggs pointed end down, because it's a forced air unit. It really doesn't matter where you put the eggs. and the numbers on top will help us keep a record of which hen laid an egg that was fertile. On a hot day, you don't want to put eggs near the motor. This generates heat also. If it's in a room where the temperatures can get to 80 degrees or more, the unit may actually overheat. The motor from the blower and the motor from the turner generate heat on their own, so if it's in a hot space on a hot summer day, the unit will actually bake the eggs. Now we'll close the unit. Keep in mind, this one's being started absolutely dry. And then we turn them back on. During the time frame when they're coming back up to temperature, expect some changes in the temperature of the unit, because the eggs will take time for it to come up to temperature again, so there'll be a delay. Don't start readjusting it. Once you know it's been set at a stable temperature, give it time to acclimate and stabilize. My greatest problem during incubation has been that the eggs don't dehydrate fast enough. The manufacturer has plugs in the tops of the incubators which limit the airflow and can increase the humidity. I don't leave the plugs in, and I remove them all throughout the incubation process. That works best for me. Your climate may be different. Now, if you've chosen to use the optional automatic egg turner, you'll have to remove the egg turner on the 18th day of incubation, which is when you'll put your eggs on the screen bottom, and remove this. If you let the eggs hatch in the automatic turner, some of the chicks may be trapped, and also the entire unit will be filthy and you'll have to sanitize it, and it's going to really be a challenge. So if you're not using the automatic egg turner, and you're going to be turning them by hand, you're going to have to mark each egg. What we do is mark a zero on one side, turn it 180 degrees, and mark an X on the other side. Make sure to use a pencil that has very soft graphite and keep the tip rounded. You have to be careful not to poke a hole in the egg, especially if you're doing this with children. They may put too much pressure on it, just poke a hole in the egg and then that one's ruined. So now each day you'll know at the beginning of the day and at the end of the day, an X or an O should be up with every egg. Now we'll load the tray. You'll also realize if you're putting your eggs in without the automatic turner, how important it is that this unit be absolutely level. If it weren't level when you went to put these eggs in, and in this case we've started off with the egg side up, they'd roll all over, they'd roll to the low side. Turn your eggs at least 3 times a day so that there's a different side up for each overnight time frame. So in the first thing in the morning you would get up and turn it to the zero side, and then around noon you turn it back to the X side, and then at the end of the day, the zero side again, so they would sit there overnight, and then follow that cycle again every day. This is the most important during the first week and a half of the incubation period. The eggs must be turned. Also, make sure that you've washed your hands and there are no skin oils before you touch these eggs. Notice the position of the thermometer. It's located with the upper third of the egg. If it's a still air incubator, this thermometer will read 102 degrees. And there's a stratified temperature layer as it goes down. So the top would be at 102, but the bottom section of the egg may only be at 98 or 99, for example. If your incubator has been used to hatch eggs before, that you do a proper sanitizing before putting in a fresh batch of eggs. If you don't, bacteria could pre-exist that would already start to form in the eggshells. The hot, humid environment that we use for incubation is perfect for growing pathogens and contaminating your eggs. Keep in mind also that these eggs have been sanitized before being put in, and sanitizers like Tektrol have a residual effect on the surface of the egg, which means they'll continue to fight bacteria after the eggs have been placed.